Hello everyone. So in today's class we shall discuss about the water quality, characteristics. So as we know, there are two sources of water. So basically, broadly, we can classify them as surface water sources and subsurface water sources. Subsurface water sources refers to the rivers, ponds, lakes, reservoirs, etc. Whereas the groundwater sources are the aquifers. Groundwater aquifers are simply the water which is lying below the surface of the earth, that is called as subsurface water. That is usually groundwater, or in common terms we call it as borewell water. Okay. So surface water characteristics, they vary physically and chemically. Okay. And it contains a huge amount of sand and silt and clay. It contains bacteria, algae and some microorganisms. Because this water has to travel, and the main source of the surface water is usually rainfall. So whenever the rainfall occurs on the surface of the land, so when it falls, it picks up all the minerals, chemicals, biological impurities, etc., sand, clay, and that will be stored in the form of river or a lake. So for that reason, the surface water will have more variations in case of the physical and chemical characteristics, and also it contains lot of clay and sand particles which will impart the turbidity to the water. So whereas the groundwater may not have much of sand and clay, okay, it is rich in mineral content and it is rich in high iron content, and it is relatively harder than surface water. Okay, so that means because this water is already filtered by the different layers of the ground when it percolates and stored as groundwater, so for that reason it will not have much of the dissolved impurities, and it will be relatively clearer than the surface water, and it may have a very high hardness compared to the surface water, because as it percolates it carries all the minerals. The minerals will be dissolved in the water and that will be stored as groundwater. Okay. For that reason, so a very minimal treatment is required, or in most of the times a simple disinfection with removal of hardness is required for treating the groundwater. Whereas for treating surface water, we need proper treatment, that means which we have discussed in a video in an earlier class with a video description, also with a flow chart of water treatment plant. Okay, that means we have to do the aeration, sedimentation, filtration and disinfection, coagulation, flocculation to remove these impurities. Okay, so we should know what are the different characteristics of the water. So we classify them majorly into three types. Okay, so before that, let us understand what are the basic terms involved in the water. So in most of our future lecture series and all, we use these terms. Okay, so let us see what are these terms mean. So first one is potable water. So what is potable water? So potable water is nothing but treated or disinfected drinking water. So the drinking water is usually termed as potable water, and also the water which is free from all forms of impurities like bacteria, excess of minerals, then the harmful organisms, the disease causing organisms, which is free from all forms of pathogens, that water we call it as potable water. So what is palatable water? Okay. So palatable water means the water which has very good taste and also the desirable temperature. Okay, so normal desirable temperature is up to 15 degree or maximum up to 20 degree centigrade. Okay, so beyond that we cannot drink the water. Okay, so even if it is less than that, that is fine, but beyond 15 or 20 degree centigrade, or if the water is hot, it is not usually, people will not find it easy to drink that water, and it should be free from all forms of color and turbidity. The water should appear clear color, and that water we call it as palatable water. So palatable is something related to the taste. If the water is we find if the water is in good taste, then we generally tend to use or drink more water compared to the unpalatable water. So contaminated water means the water which contains the pathogenic bacteria. Pathogens means disease causing organisms. It could be amoeba, it could be any bacteria, or it could be virus or anything, so which is able to cause any kind of disease, waterborne diseases. So that water we call it as contaminated water. So polluted water means any undesirable substances. Okay, so it can be the excess of mineral, excess of salts, the sand, the clay particles or dead decayed matter, ammonia, or any increased undesirable substances which is present beyond its limited concentration, we call that water as polluted water. That means we usually, you might have heard that river Ganga is polluted. Okay, so it means that it is polluted because of the undesirable substances. You know, people throw away the used items like, you know, garlands or some idols or even sometimes dead bodies into the rivers. So in that case, the water is called as polluted water. And also we can call it as contaminated water because people throw dead bodies and sometimes the animals also die and, you know, they will be reaching the rivers. So in that case, there will be the some pathogenic bacteria might be present. Okay, so you should know these terms in water. So now coming to the impurities in the water. So how the water gets polluted? So as we have seen in the previous sessions about this, our sources of water, the major source of the water is the rainfall. Okay, so whenever the rainfall occurs, so it has to pass through the atmosphere, it has to pass through the different layers of the atmosphere, and when it reaches ground again, it has to travel. Whenever it falls on the ground, it has to travel and it will reach a point maybe in the formation of river or in the formation of groundwater sources. So whenever it passes through the atmosphere, the dissolved gases and the dissolved impurities in the atmosphere will be mixed up with the rainwater, and when it reaches the ground, it mixes with the parts of silt, clay, mud or any other impurities. And when it flows towards stream, it passes through the decaying vegetating matter and some of the organic acids. Okay, so through all these things the water gets polluted. And basically the impurities are classified as physical, chemical and biological impurities. Okay, so we might, so these, all these impurities we classify them as physical, chemical and biological impurities. So let us see one by one what are these physical, chemical and biological impurities. So physical impurities means portable water characteristics. That means whatever the water we are drinking, it should be colorless, it should not have any odor, it should give good taste, and it should not contain any harmful microbial organisms. Okay, so whatever the water we drink, so it should be clear, you know, should not have any, you know, color, and should not have any odor, and it should appear good in taste. Okay, so taste usually comes from the minerals which is dissolved in the water. So these are the physical water quality parameters, which includes temperature, color, taste and odor, turbidity and conductivity. So these are the physical quality, water quality parameters. So let us see what are these physical water quality parameters and how it is measured and what is the limiting value. So the temperature should be usually around 10 degree centigrade. Okay, so above 25 degree centigrade temperature is called as objectionable. That means people will not tend to drink that water which is having more than 25 degree centigrade. So usually the 10 degree centigrade temperature is desirable. Okay, so color, the pure water should be, you know, crystal clear and should not have any bad color. Okay, so color is mainly important due to the suspended matter, due to the dissolved solids. Like when we discussed in the previous slides that when the rainfall occurs, then it picks up all the impurities, suspended matter, clay, silt, etc. Because of that, the color might have been imparted. Okay, so color is measured in color is measured. So color is measured in Asian units, and the instrument used to measure color is called as tintometer. Okay, so the desirable limit for color is 5 and maximum permissible limit is 25. So in drinking water, it should not cross more than 25 Asian units. The unit of color measurement is called as Asian unit. Okay, so next physical parameter is taste and odor. Okay, so pure water will be without any odor and it will not have any bad taste. Okay, so the taste and odor will be due to the dissolved gases. Okay, so odor is measured by threshold odor number. It is given by A plus B divided by A, where A is volume of sample in ml, B is volume of distilled water. So we compare the taste with the distilled water. Okay, and it is a measure called as threshold odor number. So by using this TON or threshold odor number, we usually measure the the taste and odor of the water sample. Okay, so for public supply, the threshold odor number should be below 3. Okay, and we use a device called as osmoscope for the odor test. Okay, so threshold odor number should be below 3. Okay, and it is you calculated by using this above formula in comparing with pure water or distilled water. Okay. So next comes turbidity. So turbidity is usually caused due to the water appears to be cloudy, which you can see here. Okay, so this is usually caused by the colloidal impurities like clay, silt, small rock fragments, and also due to some microbial population. You can see here, so this is the clear water and this is somewhat turbid, so this is some more turbid and this is highly turbid water. Okay, so this turbidity is usually caused due to the suspended and colloidal impurities. Okay, and we can measure this turbidity by the absorbance or scattering of the suspended matter by passing the light to the sample of water. Okay, and we use an instrument called as turbidimeter or turbidity meter. Okay, so the unit of turbidity meter is called as NTU. Okay, so it is Nephelo turbidity unit or nephelometric turbidity unit. The turbidity should be 10 NTU is the desirable. Usually the turbidity should be less than 5 NTU for drinking water supplies. Okay, so next we have this conductivity. So it gives the idea about the dissolved solids in water. Okay, so if the solids are more, then the conductivity will be more. Okay, so we use an instrument called as digital conductivity meter. Okay, which is similar to this, which is having an electrical conductometer with a known resistance, and this is usually dipped in the water sample, and by calibrating this instrument with standard electrode, we can measure the electrical conductivity here. Okay, so the conductivity unit is 2 moles per centimeter, or it is also called as Siemens. Okay, for drinking water, the conductivity should be less than 2 moles per centimeter. Okay, so it is, you can see the conductivity unit is reverse of the resistivity. The unit of resistivity is ohms, OHMs. So conductivity is the reverse of that. That's why here you can see the unit of conductivity as mho per centimeter. So next we have the chemical water quality parameters. So we have different types of chemical water quality parameters. So in that, the significant ones are listed here. So it is total solids, the chlorides, hardness, pH, alkalinity, acidity, nitrogen and its compounds, metal and other chemical substances, and dissolved gases. Okay, so these are the different chemical water quality parameters. landscape, which includes the salts, minerals, and different forms of chemical compounds. So nowadays, due to excess of pollution activities, a lot of chemicals are being added to the water. Hence, it is very difficult to analyze water chemically, because lot of new chemicals or compounds are added to the water, and they also change its quality, and it requires lot of careful treatment before we supply the water to the community. So let us see some of the chemical water quality parameters in detail. So first one is total solids. Okay, so the total solids consists of suspended as well as the dissolved solids. Okay, so it is the permissible limit for total solids is 500 ppm and 1000 ppm in case of industrial uses. Okay, so water is filtered through fine filter paper, and whatever material which is retained on the filter paper is dried, and it is weighed to know the dissolved solids. Okay, and it is an indirect measurement by conductivity meter. You can see here in this sample, if the solids are more, then water appears to be like this, the suspended and dissolved impurities. And here you can see, so maybe because of the addition of coagulants or by some chemicals, the solids are precipitated here, and you will have the clear water sample like this. So next we have chlorides. Okay, so chlorides are mainly present in the form of sodium chlorides and salts. So that happens due to the leaching of marine sediment deposits, pollution from sea water, and industrial and domestic water. So chloride, the salts will be added because of the marine deposits, and also due to the industrial and domestic wastewater. The permissible limit for chloride is 250 mg per limit, 250 mg per liter or 250 ppm. So you see that ppm is nothing but parts per million. Okay, ppb is parts per billion. So we usually use these units, and please know that ppm and mg per liter are same. Okay, so we can use mg per liter or also ppm or parts per million. Okay, so high quality of chloride indicate pollution of water due to sewerage and industrial waste. So it is an indicator that if the water contains more amount of chlorides, then the water is polluted due to the sewage water and industrial wastewater. So it will be usually determined in the laboratory by titrating with standard EgNO3 or silver nitrate solution using potassium dichromate as indicator, and the red color precipitate appears when you titrate it against silver nitrate, and that signifies the amount of chloride which is precipitated. And you will come to know when you do the laboratory analysis of chlorides in your next semester. So hardness is caused due to the carbonates and bicarbonates of calcium and also the nitrates of calcium and magnesium. Okay, so hardness is a property which prevents the formation of soap formation, and it will not easily give lather with the soap. Okay, so there are two types of hardness, that is temporary and non-temporary hardness. So temporary hardness is also called as carbonate hardness. So permanent or non-carbonate hardness. Okay, so temporary hardness is caused due to the carbonates and bicarbonates of calcium and magnesium. So whereas permanent hardness is caused due to the other salts of calcium and magnesium, that is sulfates, chlorides and nitrates of calcium and magnesium. Okay, so the hardness is usually expressed in ppm of calcium carbonate equivalent or milligram per liter equivalent of calcium carbonate. So usually water should not be too soft or it should not be too hard. Okay, so 75 ppm water is considered as soft water, and more than 2 ppm value if the water is having, then it is considered as hard water. Okay, so usually for drinking water, 75 to 115 ppm is, up to 115 or up to 150 ppm is considered as good water, or people should drink moderately hard water. Okay, so underground water is usually harder than surface water, that is the ground water is harder than surface water because it dissolves many minerals compared to the surface water. Okay, so we usually analyze this hardness in the laboratory by using standard ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, okay, in presence of ferrochrome black tea indicator in the laboratory. Okay, so this you will come to know in your the next laboratory course. Okay, so we also have pH, which is an important parameter. So pH is defined as the reciprocal of hydrogen ion concentration or negative logarithm of hydrogen ion concentration. It is a measure of acidity or alkalinity of the water. Okay, so you have also seen in your higher high school classes that the pH value varies between 0 to 7, 0 to 14. Okay, so if it is 0 to 7, we call it as acidic water. So if the pH is greater than 7 up to 14, then we call it as alkaline water. So if it is exactly 7, we call it as neutral water. So we usually measure the pH in the laboratory using the digital pH meters. Okay, so which is as shown here. So it consists of a standard electrode, or a calomel electrode, and it is having the control here, so with the temperature controlling knob and the calibration knob. So it is calibrated and it is measured for an unknown solution using this calomel electrode, and here it will measure the hydrogen ion potential and you will read the pH value. Okay, the permissible limit as should not be present. Okay, and the nitrate concentration in the domestic water supply, it should not cross more than 45 mg per liter. So this is the maximum permissible limit. So if it contains more nitrates in the water, then if that water is being used and drink, then we get a disease called as methemoglobinemia. Okay, so it is also called as blue baby disease. Okay, so which is associated with greater nitrate concentrations. Okay, so other than that, so we also have some of the other mineral constituents and mineralogical compounds like iron, manganese, copper, lead, cadmium, chromium, arsenic, fluoride, etc. Okay, so it should be present under permissible limit. For example, iron and manganese, it should not cross more than 0.3 ppm and 0.05 ppm in public water supplies respectively. That is, the maximum concentration of iron should not exceed 0.3 and manganese should not exceed 0.05, and it will impart the color to the water if it is present in more concentrations. And fluoride should be less than 0.1 to 1 ppm. So if it is more, it causes the dental caries or dental and skeletal fluorosis. So higher than 1.5 ppm, it causes the skeletal fluorosis. That's why the fluoride limit should be in the range of 1 to 1.5 ppm as per the Indian standards. Okay, so there is lot of problem associated with fluoride in many parts of our country. Okay, and this is the condition which is called as the dental fluorosis. Okay, so it affects the teeth. Okay, as you can see, the discoloration of the teeth happen. Okay, and the pitting, cracking, and also the chipping will happen because of the water with high fluoride content. Okay, so similarly, the skeletal fluorosis will happen. That means usually it is called as rickets in children. It occurs due to the vitamin D deficiency and also due to the excess of fluoride water. So the bones will be deformed like this. Okay, and it is called as the disease is called as skeletal fluorosis. It will be caused due to the high concentration of fluorides in the water. Okay, so this is the major problem in groundwater in most of the places. So that's why nowadays there are a lot of defluoridation techniques which are being used to remove the excess of fluoride from the groundwater. Okay, so we also have dissolved gases. So dissolved gases will impart bad odor to the water. So it could be hydrogen sulfide and also carbon dioxide. Okay, see, the dissolved oxygen should be having the sufficient, the water should be having sufficient dissolved oxygen. Okay, एंड देर शुड बी मिनिमम 4 mg/L के फर्नेस विच इज नेसेसरी फॉर फिश इन वाटर बॉडीज एंड 20 degrees centigrade the dissolved oxygen will be 9.2 mg/L and at 30 degree centigrade it will be around 7.6 mg/L. Okay, the dissolved oxygen is inversely related to the temperature. That means if the temperature increases, the dissolved oxygen decreases. Okay, for a fresh drinking water, the dissolved oxygen should be in the range of 6 to 8 mg/L. Okay, and also if there is more DO, it will cause the corrosion. So water should be having 6 to 8 mg/L of dissolved oxygen. So the carbon dioxide is dissolved from the atmosphere and also from the decomposing organic matter. Okay, so higher carbon dioxide makes water acidic. So because of that, the corrosivity of the water increases and it may corrode the pipelines and all which carry this water. Okay, and higher carbon dioxide also imparts bad taste and water. Okay, similarly we have another dissolved gas called as hydrogen sulfide. It is found in groundwater. It is produced by the reduction of sulfate or by decomposition of the organic matter. So it gives a very pungent and bad odor. It gives the smell of rotten eggs. Okay, so usually this gas is found in the sewage and also in the underground water due to the decomposition of the organic matter. Okay, so H2S will impart the bad odor. So to remove all these things, we have to do the aeration properly so that the atmospheric oxygen gets dissolved in the water and this bad odor, it gets eliminated from the water. Okay, and other than that, we have these biological quality parameters. Okay, so there are various species of biological impurities, which includes phytoplanktons, diatoms, so flagellates, zooplanktons and water plants, small water insects, protozoans, bacteria, the fungi, etc. Okay, so these things are very dangerous as it causes a very huge impact and causes various forms of diseases. So the care should be taken that the water should not be biologically polluted, and even if it is polluted, it should be properly detected, treated, and before we supply this water to the communities. Okay, so these are the various pathogenic microorganisms. Okay, that is the cyanobacteria is the very it has occurred on the surface of the earth 4 billion years ago, and we have gram positive bacteria and gram negative bacteria. So based on the stains, we classify them as positive and negative stain. So we have classification called as archaea. It is called as methanogenous and halophiles. So other than that, some eukaryotic cells are also there. We call them as protozoans, green algae, plantae, fungi, animalia, etc. Okay, so these are the various species of pathogenic microorganisms. So they are present, if they are present in even in smaller quantities, it will create a big huge impact. Like nowadays you have been seeing that new names like black fungi, white fungi in case of COVID recovered patients. So that is very dangerous, and people are being badly affected by these bacteriological microorganisms and the diseases associated with that. And these are some of the pathogens and its sizes. As you can see here, the bacteria sizes varies from in the range of 10^-1 micrometer, and viruses are relatively small than that, in the range of 10^-2 to 10^-1, and protozoans in the range of 10^-2. Okay, and nematodes and some of the worms up to the range of 10^-5, and some of the helminth worms and the tapeworms, which are usually found in the most of the organisms, most of the in pigs and other animals. So it will be in the range of 40 micrometer and up to sometimes the 6 meter. Okay, sand filter is used as we have seen in the filtration method, so it can be able to remove the organisms up to 10^-3 micrometer, and it can also strain the particles up to 30 micrometer. less than that it is very difficult to remove. So for that reason, nowadays we employ the advanced methods to in the treatment of water, like membrane filtration methods, ultra filtration, nano filtration, things like that, to remove the finer particles. So that's all for today. So maybe in the next class we shall discuss about the Indian standards for drinking water. So what are the prescribed limits? Okay, so far in this class we have discussed about the microorganisms, the physical impurities, chemical impurities, then biological impurities, what are the major impurities, what are its values, what are its limiting values, etc. Okay, so you can also browse the internet to know what are the different water quality parameters and how it affects the human health. Okay, so which water quality parameter impacts more, which water quality parameters impact less. Okay, and nowadays especially we have to take a very good care of the water quality parameters, and we have to effectively treat the water so that the people can be prevented by the spread of infectious diseases, etc. And we should see that water, whatever we are supplying to the communities, it is free from all form of impurities, and people get pure drinking water without any impurities. Okay, we shall stop at this stage and we'll continue in the next class about the water quality parameters and what are its permissible ranges and what are its desirable limits and what is happening, what happens if the water, if we use the water with high standards, the exceeding value of some of the particular parameters. Because once you know this clearly, then we can have the appropriate water treatment the technology or water treatment unit, because that is the thing which you have to learn here. Because once you know the parameter and its limiting value, then you can adapt and you can improve the technology, or you can bring in the new technology in the water treatment, so that you can treat the water effectively without much problem to the communities. Okay.